mighty name, Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. So are you ready to praise the Lord? Are you ready? Are you ready? Shall we all shout three times hallelujah? One, two, three.
Hallelujah.
One, two, three.
Hallelujah.
One, two, three.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Here you go. Shall we all clap our hands together?
Lord, how you love me one more time. Oh Lord, how you love me, I don't deserve. I think we just sang songs just now, songs of worship and praise. So our hearts should be burning. I think we should get a louder hallelujah. So once again, let us say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning to praise and worship His holy name. Indeed, our God is holy, holy forever, and there is no one like Him. So on the onset, I would like to thank God for giving me this chance, this opportunity to share from His Word. I am just an instrument standing before you, but today morning we are expecting that God will use me, He will speak to us this morning, and I am sure that He has a message in store for each and every one of us. So at this point of time, I would request us to open our hearts, open our minds, let us not be distracted, let us not look to the left and to the right, let us take this time seriously, because whatever God has in store, whatever God wants to speak to us this morning, let our hearts be open and receptive to that. And I would also like to thank our dear apostle and the leadership of the church for giving me this chance to stand here before you and to share from the Word of God. So before we move on to the Word of God, let us all bow down our heads and pray. Let us consecrate this time to the Lord. God, our Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, Lord. We just want to say thank you, Lord, for your abundant goodness, for your grace, for your mercy over our lives each and every day, Lord, that we can be here as your people, Lord, as your children, Lord, to hear from your word, Lord. We are expecting you, Lord, to feed us this morning, Lord. Our souls are hungry, Lord. We are hungry to know more from your word, Lord. Whatever you have in store for us, Lord, help us to be focused. Help our minds to be focused only on you, Lord. Help our hearts to be open and receptive to your word, Lord God. We just want to say thank you, Jesus, for giving us this opportunity to gather together as your saints to hear from your word, Lord. We know that there are other people in different parts of the world who do not get this chance, this opportunity to gather as your people, Lord. So we just want to say thank you, Lord, for your goodness over our lives, Lord. And we dedicate and consecrate this time into your mighty hands, Lord. This I pray in your mighty name. Amen. So what I'm going to be sharing this morning is, I have given the title as Living a Christ-Centered Life. So in this, as we all know, in this dark and perverse generation, living a Christ-centered life is one of the key things that we have with us. And what there are a few points that I'll be sharing this morning on how we can live a Christ-centered life. Because in this day and age today, we can see that there are a lot of things happening around the world that is twisting our minds, that is, you know, making us question God. There are things that makes us want to say, like, what is written in the Bible, is it really true? People are starting to question even the Bible, the authenticity of the Bible. So it is very important for us as children of God, as people of God, to live a Christ-centered life. Because living this Christ-centered life, it is essential. It is very essential for us in this present day and age. And I'm talking not only to the younger people present here, even for all of us who are even aged, because this applies to each and every one of us. It is just saying to live a Christ-centered life, it sounds very easy. Just speaking from the word of mouth, it is easy. But to apply that to our daily lives, especially when we are not in church, if we are in our workplaces, if we are in our colleges. It is indeed a heavy task, a heavy duty for us to show the people that around us that we indeed live a Christ-centered life. So I've just given this definition. What is basically the foundation of a Christ-centered life? So the basic foundation of a Christ-centered life is having a deep and abiding relationship with Jesus Christ. A deep and abiding relationship. These two words are indeed, they have a very in-depth meaning if we ponder carefully on the word deep and abiding. We have to have that intimacy with God, which is, you know, which is like a father and a son, or a father and a daughter, a mother and a daughter, a mother and a son. It should be so close that, you know, whatever the tiniest problems that we face in our daily lives, we can speak to God. We will not shy away to say, like, God, I am facing this problem today, or thank you, Lord, for your blessing upon me today. It should be that close. It should be that deep and abiding. You know, as family members, we love each other. We always stick with one another. So that kind of a relationship also we need to have with our Jesus Christ. Okay? To live a Christ-centered life, indeed, we need to have a deep and abiding relationship with Christ. So I have shared a few, I have around 5 points here on how to live a Christ-centered life. So let's dwell upon the points now. We'll go to the first point. To live a Christ-centered life, we need to love God with all our hearts, with all our soul, and with all our minds. We can find this from Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 to 39. It says like this, Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. So basically these verses here, they highlight the two greatest commandments that Jesus Christ had given to us. The first one, the greatest of them all, is to love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. If we apply that in our day-to-day lives, sometimes, yes, it is easy to say, yes, I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord. But is it really so? Because it is one of the greatest commandments we need to understand here. It's one of the greatest commandments that we need to love. Not just simply love, not just simply say love, but here it says to love with all your heart, the first part, the second part, all your soul, and the last part, with all your mind. It is, if we take an example, like a son telling his father, I love you, Dad, with all my heart, so we to show that expression of love, we hug our fathers, or whoever, our loved ones, that is an expression of our love. So it is exactly the same to show that expression of our deep love. Our deep love. We need to really have that heart of you know, with all our souls, with all our minds, to have that heart that we really love God. It should come from our innermost being. It's not by just saying the word of mouth. It is very simple. And the second one is, to love your neighbor as yourself. So I have a question this morning. Let us take it as a challenge as well. The second commandment, it says to love your neighbors as you love yourself. But the greatest commandment says that to love God. Okay, that's fine. But how can we say that we love God when we still have a small spark of anger towards our neighbors? How can we say that we have achieved that greatest commandment, but when the second commandment, we have not even crossed that hurdle? To love your neighbors as yourself. if someone has done something bad against you, will it be so easy for you to say that, I love you, I respect you, and you would hug them and you love them with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your minds? Is that possible? I think not. It would be very difficult. Yes, it will take time for that. You know, maybe if that person had hurt you so badly, it will take time for you to heal. But eventually, we have to heal, because if we cannot love our neighbors, how can we expect to love God? With all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds. To have that selfless love, you know, to treat others with the same care and love like how you treat your children or how we treat our parents, it is indeed a huge mountain. So let us take it as a challenge this morning. That if we have anyone who, you know, in deep inside our hearts, we still have a grudge or we still have that tiny spark of anger against someone, let us today morning decide. Okay, we take it as a challenge. We decide, today I will forgive that person and I will love that person with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my heart. Because it's like, you know, going from level to level. If we have not even accomplished level 2, how do we expect to go to level 1? How can we say that I love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, but then that my friend, I still can't forgive him or her. I still can't love him or her. So that is one of the biggest challenge for us. It is why we can't truly say that we love God with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds, because there is always someone deep inside our hearts that we still have that, you know, anger towards, that we still have that grudge towards that person. Maybe when you meet that person face to face, you say, hi, hello. But it is not genuine. Let us have that genuine, true loving nature towards the neighbor who had hurt you or towards the neighbor who had done something wrong against you. Because it is very important. It is very important for us to live a Christ-centered life, to say that, yes, Jesus Christ is the center of my life. First and foremost, I need to forgive and I need to love those people who have hurt me. And in that way, I can love God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my mind. And in that way, I can say that, yes, I am living a life that is centered in Christ. So this verse has really opened my mind when I was reading this passage, these two verses, to love God and your neighbor even when the times are rough and tough. Because when times are good, when times are easy going, for some of us, it's easy. We can love them. But when the times are difficult, when we have to cross that huge mountain or that hurdle, it is really difficult. Because these two verses, they really emphasize on the importance of love. Love towards God and love towards your neighbor as you love yourself. So let us really decide this morning, let us, you know, dig deep inside our hearts. Let us think if there is still someone that, you know, I still have that tiny spark of anger, that tiny spark of grudge against that person. Let us take it as a challenge this morning that indeed, I want to live the Christ-centered life. So I need to forgive this person. I need my heart to heal so that I can love that person with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my mind, so that I can also love God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my mind. So moving on to the next point is, if we have, you know, really loved God with all our souls, with all our minds, and with all our hearts, we can have the transformative power of Christ. If we look from Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, it says, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself to me. So in these verses, we can see that Paul himself, he emphasizes in that transformative power of Christ. Because we alone, we cannot do it. If we say, if we think about the first point, to love our neighbors, if you want to do it by yourself, it is difficult. We need that transformative power of Christ to help us to really change. Because it says, I no longer live, but Christ will live in me. To live that Christ-centered life, indeed, we need Christ to be the center. We need Christ to live in us. And we need Jesus Christ to direct our each and every part in our each and every day life. Because in this generation, in this world that we live in, it is very difficult to say it, to walk in this Christian life without God. If you do not have God in your hearts, it is very, very difficult. It's impossible. It is impossible to say that you love God, but then you do not have Christ in your hearts. You do not allow God to change you to the person that He wants you to be. Because here the verse stresses that the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself to me. I live by faith. Okay? I live by faith. It is, you know, faith comes from hearing the word of God. If we look at Romans chapter 10, verses 17, it says, faith comes from hearing the word of God. So we continuously need to spend time to read the word of God, to spend time reading the word, and not just reading for the sake of reading, but really asking the Holy Spirit to speak to us, that whatever passage that we are reading, it would edify our spirits. Because in that way, it will also help us to have more and more faith in God. Because the Bible itself says faith comes from hearing the word of God. So we should always be perceptive to, open our hearts whenever we read the Bible or whenever someone is sharing the word to you. We should not say that, that person is sharing. I don't like him. I don't like her. So I'll not listen. But faith comes from hearing the word of God. Even here, Paul, he stresses that through faith in Jesus Christ, you will experience profound transformation. If we really want to change our hearts, to love our neighbors, if we really want to change our hearts, to not have that anger towards anyone, we really need to have faith that God will transform our lives. As this verse says, that I no longer live, but Christ will live in me. In this generation, in this times, we are living in the end times, we can see many things happening around the world, and sometimes it makes us question, God, why are you not helping them? God, why is this happening? Even it's happening to our fellow Christians, fellow brothers and sisters. But then let us not question God and just have faith in Him. Because whatever God is doing, He is not just simply doing things out of nowhere, okay? He has a plan and a purpose. That is why He is doing this thing right now, or He's allowing this thing to happen right now. We just need to have faith in Him, trust in Him, because we know eventually we will see the bigger picture. Let us just not be narrow and look at what is happening in small situations, but we need to look at the bigger picture and what God has in store for us. We need to have that faith to believe, to really believe. If some of us are sick and if people are praying for us, we also need to have that faith that yes, I will be healed. Yes, God will heal me. If someone is praying for me, but then deep inside your heart say, nothing can heal me from this, or nothing can take me away from what is happening in my life right now. We need to have that faith inside our hearts. Okay? So if we have the faith inside our hearts, then we allow God to transform our lives. Okay? We allow God to transform our lives. And the third point is renewing of our minds. So if we look from Romans chapter 12, verse 2, it says, do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. So this verse, the first line itself, it says, do not conform to the patterns of this world. To live a Christ-centered life, I cannot live a life where I have one foot in the world and one foot with God. To live that Christ-centered life, we should not, it's a big no, conform to the patterns of this world. We can say, for young people present here, maybe following the trend, you know, following the social media trend or following whatever trends that is happening on Instagram, following whatever trends that we see the other young people are doing all around the world. It is, you know, it is for us, if we want to live a Christ-centered life, this I believe that this is one of the most important things, that we should not have that, you know, heart. Half of my mind is in the world, half of my mind is with God. We should give ourselves totally. We should dedicate ourselves totally to God. Because it says here, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Okay, so that's why we should maintain a distinct and morally grounded identity in Christ. Our identity as children of God should always be in Christ. Our identity should not be with what trend is going on Instagram. Okay, but our identity should be in Christ Jesus. Because why we need to live a life that reflects our faith in Jesus. Yes, I'm not saying that social media is a bad platform. We can do lots of good things through social media. We can share about our love towards God on social media. If other people are doing different things, forget about them. But we should live a life that reflects our faith in Jesus. Let us not shy away. Some of us, we see, you know, young people posting, let's say, stories or reels of them singing worldly songs. So I would like to encourage the young people present here, why not us sing worship songs and post them? Because we need to show our identity, that our identity is in Christ Jesus. We are not conforming with what is happening in and around the world, but we know our identity. We know that our faith is only in Jesus. So let us also take this as a challenge for the young people, especially. Let us not be afraid to show our faith, especially when we are in our workplaces or if we are in our colleges, in our schools. If people say things that, he's so holy, holy, I don't want to be with them, let it be. Do not try to blend in with the crowd, because when you try to blend in with the crowd, what happens then? One foot will be in the world, one foot will be with God. So, but God doesn't want us to be like that. He wants us to live a Christ-centered life. He wants our entire being, our entire lives to be with Him. And that's why we have to continually renew our minds. If we renew our minds, it will help us. You know, it will help us to live that Christ-centered life. And how do we renew our life? How do we renew our minds every day? Is to have our personal time to read the Word of God, to spend time with God, and to just simply open our hearts and our minds and be perceptive to what God wants to speak to us on that day. That is, I feel it is very important for each and every one of us to have that personal time with God. Yes, we have our family time where we gather as a family, we pray, we read the Word, and we share what the passage in the Bible is speaking to us at that point of time. But that is important. But what is most important is our personal time with God. Because that is how we build that close intimacy with God. That is how, you know, we really show God that we love Him with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds, and we want to know more and more of Him. We just simply cannot get enough of God. We know that the love of God will always overflow in our hearts, and wherever we go, people will see that, yes, that person indeed, his faith is reflecting. His identity is in Christ. I can see Jesus Christ in that person. That should be the challenge for us. You know that if people look at us, they will not see this person. They will not see our bodily person, but they will really see, like, yes, Jesus really lives in that person. Because that person is not afraid to speak about his faith. Even if he doesn't speak, people, just by looking at him, they will see that, yes, that person, he or she, really loves God. And we can see that love of God overflowing to them. And it is, you know, like spring water, like when a pipe breaks, the water is bursting here and there. That love is overflowing and it's even reaching towards the other people. And other people will be thinking, okay, something is different with that person. I want to know more. We need to have that kind of mindset. We need to have that kind of life where wherever we go, people will see Jesus Christ in us. That is what we want as children of God. And to have that, we have to have a Christ-centered life. And in order for us to have a Christ-centered life, we need to continually renew our minds each and every day. Amen? So, am I getting through? Or is it... Yes? So, the next point is to set your hearts and mind in Jesus Christ. If we continually renew our minds, after renewing, what do? Then we set our minds and our hearts in Jesus Christ. If we look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 to 2, it says, "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things above, and not on earthly things." Again, here the Bible keeps on stressing not on earthly things or not on worldly things. Okay? Because, you know, after our minds have been renewed, we set our hearts and we focus and we allow our desires to align with the values and the priorities of God's kingdom. Okay? We allow our hearts and we allow our minds to be in tune with the priorities of God's kingdom, the priorities of God's will. Because living a Christ-centered life, our focus always has to shift. We have to shift our focus continually from that materialistic world or the materialistic concerns of this world, and to shift it to the eternal and spiritual matters. Because to live a Christ-centered life, we really need to change our focus. Where is our focus? Where is our mind's focus? Where is our heart's focus? We need to shift that, and we need to simply look at the priorities of God's kingdom. We need to acknowledge that Jesus is not only our Savior, but also He is the source of truth and the giver of eternal life. We always need to follow Jesus' example. We need to follow His teachings. And in order for us to follow His teachings, we need to spend time in reading the Word of God. We need to recognize Him as the ultimate guide in our journey on this earth. If we have that Christ-centered life, we need to have God as that guide. That God will be telling us, okay, take your right foot, or you can turn right, turn left. We need God to be our guide in our lives. He needs to show us the path where He wants us to go, because eventually, God has a plan and a purpose for each and every one of us. You know, it would be very sad that if on the day that Christ Jesus comes, and Christ Jesus, and Jesus shows you, I actually wanted you to be in that position. But because you did not allow me to be the guide of your life, you are somewhere here. Now on that day, if you look at the glorious, you know, the glorious things that God had in store for you and where you are right now, we would be very, very sad. I think if it was for me, I would be, you know, crying. My heart would be broken. I would just be like, oh, I'm so sorry. We will not be able to utter a word. So that is why it is very important for us to allow Jesus to be the ultimate guide of our lives. So that He will eventually, in our daily walk, in our daily life, eventually He will lead us to the path where He wants us to be. Let us not have that regret on the day when we meet Jesus Christ that I actually wanted you to be there, but you are actually still here. So, you know, let's not have that regret on that day. Let us decide on this day today that yes, I will allow God, I will allow Jesus to be the ultimate guide of my life. That whatever decision that I am planning to take in my life, I would first consult with Jesus. I would not do it on my own because I am afraid that I would not reach that place where God has intended for us to be in. So here, we need to set our hearts and our minds in Christ. And always, each and every day, we need to shift our focus. Yes, in our busy schedule, each and every day, sometimes we are thinking more of what I need to do tomorrow morning. I need to be in the office at this time. I need to be in college at this time. Yes, that is important. But we also have to shift our focus and not forget to spend that quality time with God. And not forget to allow God to be the guide in your daily life. Because that is how it will start. It will start from your each and every daily life walk. So we need to have that. We need to allow God to do that for us. We need Him to be the ultimate guide of our life. Because if He is the ultimate guide of our life, we will, you know, we will find that purpose that God has intended for us. And the next point is acknowledging that Jesus is the only Savior. To live a Christ-centered life, we indeed need to acknowledge that Jesus is the only Savior. He is, as the Word of God says in John chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So we really need to acknowledge that. That Jesus is the only way, He is the truth, and He is the life. Because He is the one, He is the source, or He is the giver of eternal life. He is also the source of truth, and He is the way. How is He the way? He is our guide. He will lead us in that path. He will lead us in the way where He wants us to go. So here we can also see that Jesus is highlighting in this verse, He is highlighting His role in God's plan for salvation and emphasizing that He is the central figure of our faith. Jesus always needs to be the central figure of our faith. We should not be swayed to the right, we should not be swayed to the left, front or back. But He should be the center of everything that we do. He should be the center of every decision that we make. He should be the center of our daily walk in our daily lives. So we really need to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the only Savior. He's the only way for us to reach to that ultimate goal that God has planned for each and every one of us. So we really need to acknowledge that living a Christ-centered life, if we think theoretically, it sounds easy. If we, you know, just seeing these points, set your minds, set your hearts in Christ, you know, we should renew our minds. It sounds very easy. But to apply that practically in our daily lives, each and every day, to allow God to be the ultimate guide of our lives, but sometimes God is saying, go to the left, but you are, no, I want to go to the right. No. And you're having that internal conflict. Because if we think theoretically, it is always, we find it easier. Oh yeah, I can do that. And we tell people, do this, do that. But when we have to apply it to our own lives, each and every day, it is very difficult. Because sometimes, yes, in the morning we are praying, God, be the ultimate guide of my life today. Wherever you want me to be, or wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, you guide me to do that. But when God is guiding you, no, God, I don't want to. I want to go here. But God is trying to lead you here. We'll always have that internal conflict with God. But that is never the option. Because we always need to acknowledge that He is the only way, He is the truth, and He is the life. So wherever He is leading us, He will always lead us on the right path. He will never lead us astray. He will never lead us, to go through, troubled waters. Even if you have to go through, thorns or troubled waters, even have to climb the tallest of the mountains, but if God is the ultimate guide, all those things will be very easy. Amen? All the things that we are facing in life, if we allow God to be the center, to be the ultimate guide, everything, even if we have to go through the rough and tough times, but eventually things will get easier. So to live a Christ-centered life, let us recap. We need to love God with all our hearts, with all our souls, and with all our minds. And that is the greatest commandment. And the second is to love your neighbors as yourself. We also need to live a Christ-centered life. We need to allow Christ to live in us. We need to allow Him to renew our minds. And we need to set our hearts on the things that are above. We need to set our hearts on the priorities of God's kingdom. We need to always, think about doing what God wants us to do. And ultimately, we know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And to live a Christ-centered life is one that always is one that we need to follow His path. And we need to seek His love, we need to seek His teachings, because we need God to be the ultimate guide in our lives. Amen? So this morning, I would like to challenge each and every one of us. Let us allow God to be the ultimate guide of our lives. And let us allow, His faith, His love to reflect through us as children of God. Let people see that when they look at us, they no longer see this face, but they see Jesus. They see the love of God in us. And they would also want to be like us, and they would want to know more about this Jesus that we love so much, that love is overflowing from our hearts. It's even, it's becoming contagious, that people are getting infected with this infectious love of God. Let us strive to live a Christ-centered life. Let us take it as a challenge this morning that, yes, I want to live a Christ-centered life. I want, the faith of Jesus, the love of God to reflect from my life, from my daily life. So at this time, let us all stand, rise from our seats. Let us pray together. Let us decide this morning that whatever we had done, or whoever, we have a grudge against, or whoever we still feel like our neighbor, I still don't like him or her, even though I love him or her, but I do not like her. Okay, so let us decide this morning that, yes, I want to live a Christ-centered life. Jesus, you be the ultimate guide of my life. You lead me where you want me to be, and you take entire control of my mind, my heart, and my soul. So at this time, let us all pray together. Lord Jesus, we come before you this morning, Lord. We just want to say thank you, Lord, for speaking to us, Lord, that indeed to live a Christ-centered life, we need to dedicate our entire being to you, Lord Jesus. We need to allow you, Lord, to be the ultimate compass, to be the ultimate guide in our lives each and every day, Lord. We want, Lord God, that your love will overflow from us, Lord, that the people of this world, that when they see us, they would want to know more and more of you, Lord. Help us, Lord Jesus, that even if at this particular moment that we still have some sort of anger or some sort of grudge against our friends or our neighbors or our family members, Lord, help us, Lord, to decide this morning that, yes, Lord, I want to live that Christ-centered life, so I need to forgive them, Lord, and I need to love them, Lord, as we love ourselves with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds, Lord. Because that is the ultimate goal of our lives, Lord, that we want you to be the center of our lives, Lord. We want you to guide us, Lord, and help us, Lord, to love you with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds, Lord. Because we cannot do this alone, Lord. We cannot do this by our own understanding, Lord Jesus. We need you, Lord, to transform our lives, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you, Father, to transform our hearts, Lord, to have a heart of love towards our neighbors, to have a heart of love towards even the people who are doing bad things against us, Lord. Because, Lord, we want to reach that place where you had intended us, for us to be in, Lord. Help us, Lord Jesus, as your children, to really allow our hearts, to allow our minds to be connected to you, Lord, so that you would be the ultimate guide, Lord, of our lives. We dedicate our entire lives to you, Lord Jesus, that you would take control, Lord. Have your way in our lives, Lord God, because you are the way, the truth, and the life, Lord. We acknowledge that you are indeed the only Savior. You are the only one that can lead us to eternal life, Lord Jesus. So help us, Lord, this morning to decide that we, as your children, Lord, we would allow you to be the leaders of our lives, Lord. To guide us each and every path in our daily walk, Lord. Each and every day, whenever we face any circumstances, Lord. Whenever we face any hurdles, Lord. Even if through the good times or the bad times, Lord, that you would be the ultimate guide of our lives, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for speaking to us this morning, Lord. Jesus, Lord, we just want to say thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for speaking to us. For reminding us, Lord, that in order for us to live a Christ-centered life, We need to allow you to take control over our lives, Lord God. Help us, Lord Jesus, each and every day. Remind us, Lord, each and every day that we need to allow you to be the ultimate guide of our lives, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, my Father. This I pray in your mighty name. Amen. So for the glory of God, amen, I give this time to Pastor Danny.
Let's give a bigger hand to our brother. Yes. Softly he has spoken, but very powerfully. So, this is the will of God for us, to be like Jesus. What would you describe in one word about Jesus Christ? What is that? What is one word you'll describe about Jesus Christ? For me, Jesus Christ epitomized obedience. First Adam fell because of disobedience. Second Adam, Jesus, was lifted up because of obedience. So that is the word that I find about Jesus Christ. If you describe in one word, Jesus Christ, obedience. So my brothers and sisters, we have heard. So as our brother Joshua said, we have to decide to obey. Amen? Obey. Just obey. Just obey. For there is no other way. Amen? Shall we look to God in prayer? Once again, Lord, we come to you, my Father, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that you have spoken to us today, O God, that this is your will for us, O God, each one of us, O God, to be like Jesus Christ, to be like your Son, O God. Lord, yes, we know the first Adam fell because of disobedience, O God. But Jesus, your second Adam, was lifted up because he obeyed even to the point of death and death on the cross. Lord, help us, each one of us, O God, to make a decision, O God, to obey you, O God. To obey you, O God, to obey you, my Lord, my Father. And whatever you say to us, O God, without question, we will obey you, O God. And Lord, by our obedience, O God, we know truly we will be like your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for your word that you have given to us today. Help us, Lord, to decide rightly, O God, to decide immediately, O God, to put this into practice, O God, to live for you, Lord, to live a life which is Christ-centered. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, as your children leave this place, O God, bless us, O God, bless each one of us, God. Even, Lord, as we heard, O God, your word, O God, let it remain in our spirit, O God, to be flesh and blood, to be our very nature in our life, O God. May your love, Lord, my Father, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us, even those who are called upon your name, Jesus, all over the world, now and forevermore. Amen and amen and amen. God bless you.